Hello, everyone. Welcome to another Mixed Tank Takeover with me. My name is Mark Abrams, and today we are going to be reviewing mixes from the Puremix Pro members off of Puremix.net. If you're joining us off of YouTube or Facebook and you are wondering what it is that you're watching, this is a Mixed Tank Takeover. So the way that it works is every Puremix Pro member at Puremix.net can submit their mixes for feedback from the community. And then every Monday at 2:30 p.m. Eastern, I go live and I try to give some useful feedback as well. Recently, we've been starting these off with a little bit of housekeeping for the Pro members. And I've got some exciting announcements for this week as well. So first off, last Friday, we had a release with Fab DuPont mixing a song from the artist Mr. Emotional called This Is How I Feel Inside. That track was produced by Angel Lopez, who produced Kanye West, Coldplay, and most recently the Jack Harlow single that's been hovering at the top three on the Billboard 100. So you'll get to see how Fab approaches a mix from a producer that's just absolutely killing it in the pop and rap charts. We also have a mixing contest going on with Joe Ciccarelli featuring Alanis Morissette's Guardian. We have a video for that on the site, and if you've seen the video, you can download the files for it and then try everything that you learned or make your own mix of it, and then submit that for a chance to win prizes from IK Multimedia, which include the Sunset Chamber Reverbs, their Room Reverbs, the Fame Studio Reverbs, as well as Joe Ciccarelli's new Vocal Strip plugin, which is killer. So this is the last week to submit mixes for that. You guys have, we've been going at it for about 3 or 4 weeks now. So your mixes are due on August 9th. Hopefully we'll hear some of those today. And then we'll be back on August 16th for a live recap with Joe Ciccarelli, where Joe is going to choose the top three winners from that contest and announce what it is that he loved about those mixes and why he chose them. So after we do some of the mixing contest wrap up, we'll do a live Q&A as well. So if you have questions for Joe, that'll be the time to get them in. That week, at the end of the week on August 19th, we'll be wrapping up Vance Powell's Start to Finish series with the Weird Sisters. And if anybody's been following along in that series, the band actually finished the song, finished the mix, everything was good. And then Vance got a call that they had an idea for a new bridge. So they basically came back into the studio, recorded a new bridge for the song, inserted it, and then Vance remixed it. So we'll have that entire saga unfolding on August 19th as one release. So yeah, without further ado, we've been starting these off with a little bit of kind of a thought or a takeaway for it before we jump into the mixes. So for today, I wanted to talk about vocal recording because something that we've been hearing quite a bit as a sort of a common theme in these Mixed Tank Takeovers is the recording quality of vocals, and then things like lip noises, smacks, S's, pops, all of that kind of stuff. And there's a couple things that you can do during the recording process to make your life a lot easier during the mixing process. And a lot of that has to do with microphone placement. So I wanted to call some attention to one of my favorite videos on Puremix, and that is the recording vocals with one microphone video from Fab DuPont. So Fab shows you exactly what he does when he goes to record a vocal. And the cool thing about this is he's got a great singer in there. And he shows you the wonderful things that you get from something like proximity effect when the singer is right on the microphone and it's intimate and detailed and it sounds amazing, but also points out the problems like too many pops, too many S's, all of those kinds of things. So then he'll play with the placement, move it back. You'll notice how some of the stuff that he liked goes away, but there's other bonuses to it. And then he works to find a compromise between the two and find a really well-balanced vocal. This video changed how I record vocals, like from the moment that I saw it. And not only vocals either, it also affects, you know, you can take these things that you'll learn from this video and bring them to things like recording acoustic guitars, guitar amps, drums, anything, you know, that you mic up. You'll find a way to incorporate some of the techniques from this video. So that's today's takeaway, and I think it's time to jump into some mixes. So this is Mix Tank, and on the left, you'll see that we have a pool of submissions from people where they've entered their mixes for a chance to be reviewed on the air here. And I've got a button up here that says draw a track. This is how we kind of keep it fair. This will randomly select one of those mixes, and then we'll take a listen to it, and I'll try to give some useful feedback for it. Over on the far right, We've got the person's name, their level, where they think this mix is at. So in this case, this person thinks it's an advanced mix. And then they put some details about how they're feeling about the mix or things that they're looking for some feedback on. Where it says no feedback in the center, that's where you'll see other users' comments. And I'll be dropping a comment there that says Mark was here with the link to the YouTube video. And you can go check out what I had to say. So let's jump in here. We'll be going for about an hour and a half today, probably till about 4 o'clock. And let's get started. So I'm going to hit draw a track. Let's see what we get. There's our confetti. This is a song called Frey from the user Normie, and it's a master. So he says, this is the first song I produced and mixed for another artist. We tried to keep the arrangement minimalistic. I love it. The artist comes from Cameroon and took the challenge to sing in German. We started with one guitar and the vocals and arranged it in Ableton using samples and virtual instruments. All right, let's check it out. Here we go. Hey guys, my apologies, you weren't getting the sound. Here we go, let's start over again. Here we go.
Lass uns reden über das Leben, über deine Ängste und unsere Liebe. Von all deiner Lüste ist dein Verstand als Geisel genommen. Deine Welt wird immer düster, bewohnt von tausend Dämonen. Lass mich dich von deiner Kette befreien, so dass wir zusammen in den Himmel fliegen. Oh, Zauber, das ist ein Traum.
right. Great track. Awesome job, man. Loving the feel of this thing. And I dig the Ableton kind of style arrangement that's going on with it, mixed in with the acoustic stuff. Think it sounds great. A couple of things that I noticed in it. It feels, the first thing that jumped out to me is that it's really wide. This is another thing that's like kind of a common thing in these, is there's so many plugins that have stereo expansion on them. And the first taste of that is really, really good. The aftertaste, not so much. Sometimes it can be like reverb, and it becomes one of those things where you go back and listen to it later and you're like, oh wow, I cooked it, you know, or like I put too much of that in the sauce. So I feel like this is unnaturally wide, and it's mostly coming from those reversed guitars, which is a super cool effect. I love that. But I'm wondering if there's another way that you could get a more wide feeling mix without doing some of the phase tricks that are sort of happening inside of this mix. So that could be panning stuff. It could be effects around those instruments. It could be putting some space on them, and not reverb in the, you know, chamber or hall sense, but doing some sort of a room on it that just gives it a little bit of a push. And then being careful to not put everything on the side. So not going 100% left, 100% right with elements, and leaving a little bit of space out there for some of that time-based stuff to swirl around a little bit. If you leave a little bit of room on the edge of the frame, you know, so to speak, you can kind of make things feel wider without doing a bunch of phase stuff on it. So one like visual representation of that would be if you've ever seen like a picture that's 2D, but they're trying to make it look 3D, they might have a frame that's drawn around the picture, and then the character, like if it's a, you know, something is coming out of the frame, it'll come over the frame a little bit to sort of look that way. So that's kind of what I mean about leaving some space on the sides, not panning everything out super wide, and then using that little bit of space for some other kind of things that'll tell your ears that things are wider than they seem or whatever. And then aside from that, the acoustic feels a little thick and muddy, and like it's poking out on some notes, which might lead you to jump for a compressor, but I'm hearing that mostly in some resonance in the low mids. So sometimes if you just deal with that stuff with an EQ, you don't need to compress at all. So just watch out for resonances and see if you can kind of tweak that around with an EQ and deal with some of that stuff that might be jumping out. And then if not, you could play around with a little bit of compression. But important takeaway there is, you know, think of your EQs as an alternative to compression sometimes, and you might get some good results that, you know, don't come with the artifacts of compression. Another thing was in the vocal, I felt like there was a lot of mouth noise. So I was hearing like lip smacking between phrases. You know, while he's waiting to sing his next phrase, he's doing a little bit of the like lip smacking kind of stuff. Quick, easy way to fix that: Isotope mouth declick, default settings, just process the vocal and it's gone. It's an amazing plugin and it doesn't destroy your vocal sound. So definitely check that out. The vocal also felt a little bit thin and bright compared to other elements in the track. And that makes me think that the vocal was kind of EQ'd or processed without thinking about the relation or the tone or the shape of the rest of the band and the elements that are happening inside of the mix. So it's got a really like interesting high top end on it, but in relation to the rest of the tracks, it sounds like it's part of a different record. So I would say like watch out for it getting a little bit thin or boxy, and make sure that, you know, you're kind of filling out the whole thing. Look for frequencies that make the vocal kind of speak and come alive if you boost them a little bit. Sometimes you can do that just like grabbing a band on your EQ, pulling it up and just kind of moving around until you feel like the vocal comes alive. That's an awesome trick for just bringing out the excitement of something without doing it by, say, taking like the air band on a Moog and just trying to get it to sound really bright. The other thing, I felt like the vocal could come forward a little bit, and a little bit of parallel compression could do that. One trick that I love is Devil Lock Deluxe, the factory default setting again. I'll put that on another track, like an aux, so I have it on a fader, and just kind of bring that up and in. And that'll make the vocal feel like it's moving a lot closer to me, which is amazing. I love that trick. I feel like this could stand to use that a little bit because the acoustic feels a little more forward to me than the vocal does. And I want to hear the vocal because it's really cool that they're singing in German. So I hope that helps out a lot. I love the production on it. I think you guys are on the way to something really cool here. All right, there's my comment, and we're going to draw another track. Here we go. Okay, this one's called Ghost from Josiah, and we've got our notes over here just looking for overall constructive criticism on the song. Thanks, peeps. All right, here we go. Love the synth sounds in this. Killer. Killer song. This is awesome. Yeah, this is great. I hear some stuff, but that was fun. That was fun. Listen. Awesome. Okay. So let's go to the beginning. One, again, I love those arpeggiated synths. All those tones are amazing. The programming school, this is a really great song. The singer is awesome. Let's talk about some stuff to bring out those things that are amazing. So at the very beginning, there's a lot of low sub rumble on the intro, and that's coming from that kick that's happening there. Those are going to be the biggest subs that you're going to have in this song. Like that feels like that's about as loud as the sub energy is going to get. And to give that away for free in the intro feels very generous of you, but I think that you should save it for later. I think that in here, we're trying to build interest and draw the listener in and everything. And that sub energy, is something that I would want to save for when the first chorus hits and use it to kind of push things forward. that happens at 1:15, where everything kind of drops around 1:15-ish. Everything drops in, and I feel like I'm missing all the sub. The kick actually feels thinner there than it did to me in the intro, where it was really thick and had some bottom to it. So that was something where I feel like the energy graph, you know, if we had an energy graph of our song of how we want things to go and be exciting as the song moves along, I feel like we lost energy on the chorus, which we want to be going up there, because we didn't have the same sub energy that we had at the beginning. Later in the song, I felt that sub energy come back to the drums, which we'll talk about in a second. Moving on, the next thing for me was that the vocals are very kind of thin, and they're piercing between like 2.5 to 4 to like 3K. And a popular thing that you'll kind of hear on social media and everything right now would be like, oh, Soothe will take care of all of that. And it will, in most cases. But I'm wondering if instead of like trying to attack that range and make it less harsh there, because it's so thin, if we just bring back some of the body of the vocal, I don't think that stuff is going to be as much of a problem, because that sound's going to be a little bit more balanced. So in this case, it feels to me like the vocals are just high-passed a little bit too much, and it's causing things to get a little bit thin. I felt like that kind of happened in some of the synth stuff at the end too. Like all of those patches sound amazing, and they might even be from an analog, you know, board, and there's a whole lot of tone there, but I feel like some of it's being carved away. When we get to the end of the song, especially around the 3 minute mark, I felt like the drum kit and the synths were the star of the show. So I'm going to just play this again, and thinking about, you know, what's important in the mix, let's just listen to who the stars are here. I think this is a good moment. So, let me get a little bit closer. Here we go. I'm just going to play a second of it. And then right in here. So I feel like the drums and the synths and everybody are just stepping in front of the vocal a little bit too much. And part of that might just be that the vocal felt piercing to you, so you were writing it down. Another part of it might be that you produced the track and you wanted to hear all that stuff, and it just kind of started creeping in front of the vocal a little bit. The kick feels like it's closer to me than the snare drum, and then the vocal feels somewhere back here and all that. If you haven't seen one of these before, I think a lot of balanced things in terms of depth, not just like left or right things in the mix, but doing depth in the mix, and a lot of that is done by balance. So yeah, the kick feels really forward to me. The synths feel like they're coming out in front of the vocals, and they sound amazing. And I actually talked about a song a couple weeks ago from an artist named Sohn. It's like John, but with an S instead of a J. And that song at the end, everything goes into complete chaos mode and envelops the vocal and everything like that. So that's a cool production trick too. Just I think you could be even more intentional with that if you want everybody to swallow up the vocal there. But yeah, this is a killer song, and I hope to hear another mix from it too. So if you put up another one, let me know. You can comment in this player, or you can reach out to me, mark@puremix.net. So okay, let's draw another track. Here we go. Okay, this is Black Tuesday from Gord, and I'm going to hit play and get into it.
1929 and the stock market crash. Babies born, no man up for the task. Her other son had just turned one. Her parents said, we can't be two. It's Black Tuesday, gotta say. Photo and 1929 and the stock market crashed. Baby's born, no man up for the task. 4 years later, she married a man. They raised two kids and her first son. The papa grew up 100 miles away. Born on Black Tuesday, no, he couldn't stay. Wonder if Grandma cried for her lost one. Thought maybe as a man that he could have a son. Hoped if he did, he'd stay to raise that boy. On Black Tuesday, she was on her own. On Black Tuesday, it was all unknown. That was Grandma. Smile was nice, could see the man might even look twice. 1929 and the stock market crashed. Baby's born, no man up for the task. Wonder if Grandma cried for her lost one. Thought maybe as a man that he could have a son. Hope
Awesome job, Gord. It's a really, really fun song. That's cool. Okay. All right. We'll check about what's happening in the chat in a second. But let's put out some comments on this one. So love the lyrics of it. Love the songwriting. I think you did a great job there. It's really cool. I also really like the arrangement that's going on here. You've got like the cool bass sound. I dig the drums. I think that they're programmed. We'll talk about that in a minute. And then the piano, organ, and guitar that are all happening. So one thing that's going to be tricky about this mix is a lot of those instruments are playing parts that are in the same register, right? So you've got the same note with a different timbre coming from a different instrument, but they're all in that same frequency range, taking up the same space. So you're going to have, obviously, that's probably a whole thing that you've been struggling with in the mix, is like, how do I find a space for each one of those things? So panning can help, but also just kind of trying to decide the tonality of those instruments and making them complement each other. Balance is huge. Automation is huge. Bringing one up when it's supposed to be the star, bringing the other guys back when they're not as important, and not having them just kind of static in level would help out a lot with that, I think. And then just, yeah, again, like just playing with EQ, playing with the shape of those sounds and trying to make them all sit together is going to be really helpful. I felt a lot of bunching up in the kind of in the mids, upper mids, you know, maybe 1 to 4K or something like that. I don't know. The vocal feels a little bit thin. I love the slap delay on it and think you should totally keep that. But I also heard a lot of over de-essing on it, which was stealing away some of your articulation from, you know, the diction of the vocal. So watch out with de-essers that you're not taking off the S's completely and making it sound like you are not producing those while you're singing. If I had to guess, totally a guess, but my guess would be that you EQ'd the bottom out of the vocal and then noticed that the S's were getting pretty extreme. So then you put a de-esser on it to address that problem. This is like a, you know, maybe that's not what happened, but it's a typical path to this kind of thing where, you know, you deal with the bottom of the vocal, you make it really shiny, and then you're like, oh, the S's are really grinding my ear off. So you throw a de-esser on it, you overdo it, and then the person sounds like they have a lisp and they can't, you know, produce all the sounds. So I'm wondering what would happen if you started over on the vocal sound, try to get a natural, even sound across the vocal, and then see how much of that de-essing you actually need. Definitely do a save as if you try it, of course. And I would recommend doing a save as on the whole thing anyway, and bringing all the faders down, and then just, you know, maybe just bring up the vocal and bring in everybody around it, and see what happens if you can get that balance to be a little bit more complementary to the vocal sound and to the other instruments that are happening inside of the track. But I think that this is awesome. It's a really good song and well produced and everything. So yeah, good luck with it, and I hope it helps. And I look forward to hearing another version of it. Okay, so let's see what's happening in the chat. So people are loving the sounds. Great Fox, I see you. Pomelo asks, how can I submit a song? So Pomelo, this is Mix Tank. This is from puremix.net. We have a website, puremix.net, if you would have guessed. And up at the top, you can hit Mix Tank. And if you're a pro member, you can submit a mix for the community to drop feedback on. And then we're live here every Tuesday at 2:30 p.m. Eastern and trying to give some comments live. But all week long, the community is dropping in comments, and there's some really, really good people in there talking about you know, what might help out a mix if they're listening to it from you. Okay, so Zion, you're asking, will you check out my mix? I also have some doubts I want to clear. Awesome. So we do this at random. I have a draw a track button up here, and the brilliant programmers in Bordeaux at Puremix made this little button for me. So it draws a random track, and that way we keep it kind of fair for everybody. So it's not like just taking, you know, one person that submitted 5 minutes before the stream started or something. So totally random. It's the most fair way that we could think to do it. And with that, I'm going to push that button. Okay. Hey. All right. Sometimes it plays on me before I'm ready. All right. This is from Joseph Mena. This is an early mix. Worked on the low end and went into the levels and fixed it how I like it. Went into the vocals and took a bunch of mud out. What do you guys hear? Let's see.
En mi mente es algo como yo te puedo decir. Esta vida es dura, pero a mí me gusta así. Que me digan lo que digan, solo soy lo que soy. Y la gente está buscando que hagas un error. Todos sufrimos, pero pocos saben vivir. Sean tontos, todos se van a morir. Y por eso yo canto, sonrío y siempre soy feliz. No estés buscando algo que está en ti. Y por eso yo canto, sonrío y siempre soy feliz. No estés buscando, hey, algo que está en ti. He llorado miles veces por la gente. Y todo lo que he aprendido, que tienes que amar la soledad. Porque me llama el diablo y se ríe. Mi mente es algo, me hace sufrir. Yo le digo en la cara que en esta alma no puede vivir. Yo no le tengo miedo, yo no sé qué es. Es algo dentro de mí que me dice que no voy a vivir así. Tengo el amor, el motivo, más que siempre brille el sol, que honor está vivo.
Okay, awesome, Joseph. I'm gonna go forward here, just see if anything else happens here in the song.
Es la ley, de nuevo a Japón, back to LA. nada al dinero. Siempre yo gano, I do it my way. La gente familia juzgando, diciendo que no lo puedo hacer. Ahora el loco lo hizo, les dije que mire a mamá.
Y por eso yo canto, siempre yo, y siempre soy así. No estés buscando algo que está en ti. Y por eso yo canto, está en ti.
Okay, awesome. Great job putting this together, man. Very cool. So yeah, in the track status, you say early mix. So there's some things I think that we could hit to make this thing pretty awesome. So first thing, I totally dig the vocal. I love the performance of it. It's really hard to do energy like that and character like that in a vocal. And I think you're killing it. So kudos there. And overall, the vocal tone, we'll talk about that for a second. It feels a little bit overcompressed to me, and it's really separated from the rest of the mix. Especially if we look at the verse, everything kind of feels ambient, and the vocal is dry, and it's right on my nose. Which, like, I like forward vocals, but that feels like it's just completely separated out of the elements of the rest of the mix. So that's one thing to kind of think about is... as you're balancing these things, thinking about the space that other elements live in and the distance away from you that they are, it's harder to do this if you're mixing on headphones. And a vocal level that feels this separated is pretty easy to do on headphones. It's usually one of the hardest things to balance on headphones is the vocal. So if you're on headphones, try turning the volume down a bit lower and just seeing if the vocal is too separated for you. But also... considering like the space that's around the elements in the verse and everything, I think that you could do some things to just add a little bit more, you know, depth to the vocal and dimension to it. The first chorus at 45 seconds gets more quiet. The guitars and the cymbals start poking out and they get harsh. And then compared to the verse, we have no bottom in our kick. The drums are recessed and they're not punching the same way. So I'll just play a little bit of that. So we'll go from the very end of the first verse into the chorus and just listen to that.
Poco saben vivir. No sean tontos, todos se van a morir. Y por eso yo canto, sonrío, y siempre soy feliz.
So things get smaller. That tambourine's really, really loud. And I would take a look back at the production side of this and just see if there's something you can do with those drums. Maybe it's more of a hybrid thing where you're using the sample that you have from the verse on top of the kick and you do like a hybrid electronic acoustic kit thing. But I think that the whole rhythm section needs to have a bit more punch to match the energy that's happening in the vocal there. Yeah, I hope that helps. The other thing that stood out to me was the guitar solo felt a bit thin and recessed along with the drums. So the guitar solo is happening. I hear like the banjos and the acoustics are wide and they're up front. The solo feels verbed out and I like how it's moving around and everything. I think you have some creative choices there, but it feels like it's really far back in the mix when it's clearly from an arrangement standpoint, the star at that moment. So we need to let the listener hear it a little bit more. It's my opinion of it. I hope that helps, and I think that you're doing something really cool here. Same thing, like the verses feel awesome. The chorus has a cool feel to it. I just feel like it needs a little bit more excitement in the production, but this is going to be a cool song. So good luck with it. It says it's an early mix. I hope you submit the next version of that. Okay, there's my comment, so you know I was here. And I'm going to draw another track. Let's see how you guys are doing in the chat here. Ah, the solo music, that's your track. Sweet. All right, great. Thanks for joining in. Yeah. Yeah, very cool. Looks like people dig it in there. Very cool. Awesome. Good to have you here, man. Thanks for joining. All right. This song is called Jealousy from Mix in the Cloud. And oh, cool. Okay, so this track is, there's a couple of mixing videos of this track on the site, and it was recorded by Mick Guzowski, who did Daft Punk's Random Access Memories record, which sounds incredible, as well as like so many classic records, Earth, Wind & Fire, and just the list is huge. So Mick is one of our favorite mentors on the site, and super happy to have him. But yeah, this track is from an artist called Brandy and the Alexanders. There's a bunch of videos on the site about it. You can download the files from us and have a go at it. So Mix in the Cloud is here with his master version of it. And I'll read these comments as we go. Here we go.
Jealousy.
This vocal is so good.
Shows me things I don't want to see. Jealousy holds me back from who I'm meant to be. Why you gotta make me feel so defeated? Why you make me look so green in the eye? Boy, you overpower me so instinctively. No matter where I run, I just can't overcome.
Awesome. Cool. Mix in the Cloud. I noticed that you're in the chat. Welcome. Thanks so much for submitting the mix, and thanks for being here. This is great. Man, I love this song. I've heard it many times, and I still love all the moments that happen in it. So yeah, this is cool. Great job on this. Yeah, we'll just talk about some of the main things that jumped out to me. I noticed at the end here, I was just kind of scrolling through some of the comments from Sonic Science Lab, and I saw some of your responses on it. So we'll chat a little bit about that. Tom Foolery always has great comments, always good things to say on here too. And Okay. Cool. Yeah, let's chat. So, first thing, vocal feels a little bit thin to me. This is a really hard vocal to mix. Really hard vocal to mix because she is so freaking powerful and she has so much energy in that like 2K, 3K pain area that just like comes out and jabs your eardrum a little bit. But her voice is so powerful that you kind of like forget it. But I think that some of the bottom of the vocal is missing from it. And because of that, if you think about when you take out a frequency, it obviously makes the other frequencies more present, right? So it's, you can think of it as you're subtracting EQ, but when you subtract EQ, you're also giving more priority to higher stuff. And if you go too far on it, you're boosting that stuff. It's almost like you're EQing it anyway, right? So what I think is happening here is there's a little bit of the body of the vocal isn't being enhanced the same way that, say, like the top of the vocal is. I know I can, like, there's a lot of air being added to this vocal to give her a nice R&B, like modern pop, beautiful, you know, rich sound to it. But I feel like in doing so, it's losing the body of the vocal. And then as a result, we're getting some more of that pain area. I mixed this song myself, and I know that that was one of the hardest things to work on in this mix, was just getting that vocal to be pleasant in that area. So that brings to mind a thought that I've had about when you're dealing with problems like this on either a temporary or a permanent basis, right? So tools that we would use for something where, like, say that every single word that she sang had a harshness 2.5 to 3K, right? We would take an EQ band and we would notch that out and we would move on with our day. The problem is that that doesn't always happen in the song. It only happens when she hits, you know, certain frequencies or certain notes, then that stuff kind of jumps out and jabs us in the ear. So basically that tells us it's a temporary problem. So we're not going to apply a global EQ curve to deal with something like that. We might do automation things where either we're just riding the vocal, which I would start with, not changing the tone of it, and just try, like, if she starts poking out, see if a little bit of a fader ride will help her sink into the track a bit and make it so that some of that stuff isn't as harsh. Again, I think if you deal with the bottom of the vocal first, that stuff won't be as painful. But also, yeah, playing with automation from a level basis, but you could also automate EQ bands. I wouldn't go insane with this and over the top. Like, it's one of those easy things to do where we start getting, like, our nerd brain starts to take over and he says, excuse me, move aside, let me sit at the keyboard. And then he starts drawing 1,000 automation moves on 40 bands of EQ and it just goes insane. And, you know, you need to tell that guy to leave the room. But if you have that guy, maybe I'm the only guy who has that guy. But, the main thing is, do you deal with a temporary problem or are you dealing with a permanent problem? So, you know, again, like going back to the soothe thing, soothe can be useful for stuff like this if you feel like it's a global thing. If not, just deal with it in the problem areas. I think I have a note here. Check out. So vocal delays and effects on verse 2. Where the band pulls back and they're doing like these long, they're like accenting and then doing these long sustained things here. I want to play this section and I want you to focus on the vocal effects that are happening here and the groove of the rest of the band. So we'll just listen for 1 second. Here we go. Jealousy. So specifically on the SY of jealousy and then on heart, one more time, listen to the delays and stuff that are going on compared to this feel that the band's doing. And the hi-hat's barely keeping time in there. Everybody feels kind of drunk and hurt and like they're sagged over the piano and everything. But listen to what the vocal delays are doing.
Jealousy. You take your knife and you cut it through my.
So for me, it's messing with the groove of that. So the band is trying to tell you, like, we want to go, smack, delay, smack, and leaving all this space in between notes. So filling up that space with effects on the vocal, if it's not something like just a throw down a chamber and adding some, you know, ambience to that space in between the notes. Now you're adding a subdivision, right? You're adding another note to the groove. And if the band's trying to play this super lazy, laid back thing, but you go jealousy, see, it's not actually doing that in this, obviously. But if you do that, you're changing the feel of the band and what their intention was. So that's just something to watch out for. This is completely a taste thing, and you decide along with the artist about whether or not that's, you know, a thing or not. But it's something I would watch out for. Like, if I got this song into mix and I just received a folder full of tracks and I was listening through it, I would first listen to the rough mix to see if they did anything there. But I would definitely be wary of how much pull they're doing on the groove. And if I was going to fill that with a vocal effects, I could really be messing with their intention of the groove. So I wanted to point that out. And other thing I saw in the other comments too, they're commenting on it. As we move into chorus three, the whole mix feels like it starts to clip. It doesn't sound like it's just on the vocal, but it could be. There's just some distortion stuff happening in there. I saw you say that you thought it was baked into the mix. I don't remember it being baked into the mix when I mixed it, but it was a couple years ago. So just watch out for it. See if there's something you can do. There's a lot of great declipper tools out there too. Isotope makes great stuff for that. And then the last thing I had was just the background vocals, chorus three. The ooze felt like they were stepping out a little bit far, coming out in front of the lead vocal, as though, like, I've kind of made jokes about this before, but if you had the background singers on stage, it'd be like they walked off of that platform that they put background singers on, and they walked out right in front of the singer and, like, lined up so you couldn't see her. And they just started singing ooze or whatever. So I always like kind of have visuals about that kind of stuff. Like whoever is the person that we're supposed to be listening to at that moment, they would be the person that's closest to the crowd or closest to you, the listener. And it's really funny if you think about, like, you know, the singer, like, she's delivering that vocal performance at the end. But if the bass player, like, came running out from the back of the stage and stepped in front of her and just started, like, doing the rock out wide stance or whatever, it would be ridiculous, right? So that's the kind of stuff that I watch out for when I'm blending in multiple vocals or things like that, like guitar solos and everything. But I think that you're off to an awesome, awesome mix. And this is really cool. So lots of great stuff happening in here. Mostly just watch out for the harshness in the vocal. I hope that that helps and the explanation was useful. 6/8 groove delay. Cool. Okay. Yeah. He's in there. Nice. Calm says, sir, I'm in help. Please help me out. Calm, what do you need? What do you need, Calm? Let us know. All right. Not capturing your vocals through your microphone. All right. Calm, we'll come back to that later. I don't think I can help you with that right now. Hit me up, markatpuremix.net. I'll help you. Okay. I'm going to draw a track. Here we go. Okay. We already got this one from Gord. We're going to draw another track. Already got this one from Gord. Another track. Okay. I wish you peace. Mondak Ryan. Ryan, I remember your email, so I'm going to make sure I haven't been here already. Hey, Mix in the Cloud put a comment on there. That's awesome. It's so freaking cool when everybody is helping each other out. Okay, I don't think I've heard this yet, unless I forgot to leave my comment. So I'm going to listen and we'll see.
I wish you peace when the cold winds blow, warmed by the fire's glow. Well, I wish you comfort in the lonely time, and arms to hold you when you ache inside. I wish you peace when times are hard, a light to guide you through the dark. And when storms are high and your dreams are low, I wish you the strength to let love grow.
Killer performances.
wish you hope when things are going bad. Kind words when times are sad. Well, I wish a shelter from the raging wind. Cooling waters at the fever's end. I wish you peace when times are hard. Oh, a light to guide you through the dark, yes. And when storms are high and your dreams are low, I wish you the strength. I wish you the strength to grow, to grow, to
Ryan, that's a great song. Wow. The right off the bat, I felt like way more calm. You know, it was like within the first 10 seconds, I felt like you calmed me down. Thanks, Ryan. I needed that. All right. We'll just jump right into it. I really don't have much for this because I think it's great. There's so much that's done so well. What a beautiful vocal sound and everything too. Like, she killed it. The vocal tone feels a bit bright to me compared to the guitar, and Mixed in the Cloud actually left a comment on there saying the crispness of the vocals, while technically fine, just seems to work against the mellow smoothness and nature of this composition. So yeah, against the guitar, I would say there. And I agree, like a warmer vocal would feel really, really good on this. Just kind of tucking back in. And an important thing to think about here is, like, you're not always trying to make a sound the most amazing that it can. This is a place where context comes into key. The way that the guitar is so mellow and smooth should dictate how the vocal tone is going to come across as well. Because if she's unnaturally bright, it's going to feel like it's a separate recording, or like they weren't in the same year, even. You know, he could feel like he's in the 50s and she's in, you know, Ariana Grande's studio, making the vocal sound as bright as she possibly can, and the glasses are breaking on the shelves behind her. But I would probably just bring that back in a little bit closer to the guitar. That I think if you nail that vocal tone, most of this other stuff kind of doesn't even matter, because the performance is so good that it's really one of those songs where it's like, let's put the faders up and it's going to come across really well. So I noticed some noise. I think it's in the guitar. It might have been in the vocal. There was a part where I felt like it went away but came back when the vocal came back. So just figure out where it's coming from. But Isotope, again, I'm like shouting them out a lot today. Their noise reduction stuff is incredible, especially for taking buzz out of signals. So I would consider just seeing if you can clean up that noise a bit, because this track is so sparse that it's sticking out enough that it's distracting on there. But if it kills the tone of any of the instruments, then I wouldn't worry about it too much, because once again, I feel like the song is so good that a noise thing isn't worth sacrificing the tone of one of the instruments on this tune. When all of the BGVs were in and happening together, I feel like they really got bunched up in the mids. And I would just look at your treatment of each of those background vocals together and make sure that they're not all pushing the same frequencies. I would consider putting them in different spaces, maybe, like even if it's very, very short reverbs or just a room. Do something to kind of separate those BGVs from each other and from the lead vocal, because once they all come in, everything gets a little bit too crispy and a little bit, you know, kind of busy in the midsection, and it sort of hurt the ears a little bit. when it gets to the word strength and the beautiful vocal cord does the pad feel, they feel a little awkwardly wide to me. And I get that you're going for like a lot of space. You want to envelop the listener and everything, but they feel unnaturally wide compared to the rest of the tune that I've been listening to for 3 minutes. When those came in, I felt like, wait, there's like another 50 feet on the canvas outside of here. And it feels unnatural and phasey to me. So I don't think you need it. I think you'll accomplish that same thing if you just try, 100% left and right and skip any outside the speaker stuff. Especially again, like this is an intimate track. I don't think it needs to wrap around your head quite as much. But great job, Ryan. I think the song's amazing, and congrats to you guys on those performances and the song. So cool. Let's see. All right, I'm gonna hit draw a track. Let's see what we got. Hard Rock version 1.0. Hold on. All right, this is an advanced mix from Timothy. Thanks for submitting, Timothy. Let's check it out. So I'm going to pause here for a second and just kind of comment what I'm hearing right now. Vocals and guitar live in the same frequency range. Sonic Science Lab commented on that as well here. Very bottom of the guitar that's strumming, it sounds like there's some sub-thumping going on, so maybe consider doing high pass or just taking some of that down. But the guitars are the star of the show here so far. They're coming out in front of the vocal. The amps are turned up louder than the PA. And I'm wondering if I should be listening to the singer or the guitar player at this moment. So let's keep going. Here we go.
In the game with no hesitation.
The noise from the guitars comes in before the guitars does right there. I would tighten up your edit a little bit and then do a crossfade right into the first note of the these wide rhythm guitars that are coming in right now. Here we go. Okay, so here the lead vocal is telling me I should be listening to it. That feels good.
Oh God, take a side of the tide. Give us a chance to rise and show the way.
There's a weird glitch happening there. Watch your edit.
To find out how it feels.
I think that I'm hearing the pick of the bass come out really strong here, and it sounds like it could be like it's, you know, the bass is down in compression really hard, and then the compressor's letting go on the pick noise and trying to slam really quick. Take a listen.
Wasting on a time revolving, riding around the same old stories, don't step back.
I think that's what it is, but it could be something in the drums too. All right, going back to where we were. Here we go. Weird noise there, ground something.
Feel the fire. Let yourselves go, let yourselves dive. You have just crossed that party line. Once you got in, there's no rewind. Just a dream escape away from your life
tonight. All the feedback. I love it. I love the chord choice at the end of the song there. That was killer. Very cool. There's a lot of awesome stuff happening in the song. This is a great performance, great band. I heard like one or two little groove things here and there, mostly on the drum fills. I would just check those out and see if you could just tighten them, because everything else feels really tight. So yeah, like this could be really, really awesome. I'm hearing some stuff. I see Sonic commenting on it too. There's the things I already mentioned, like where's the vocal in the beginning compared to the guitars and everything. But specifically the drums, let's talk about that for a second. It sounds to me like the kick and the snare could be samples, but they're really quiet, except the kick is not quiet all the time. But they're not adding the kind of energy to the song that they feel like they should be. And if I was like, you know, doing audio forensics here, I would guess that this was mixed by the guitar player, because the guitars feel like they're supposed to be so forward, and like they're so forward in this current mix, and everybody else is kind of recessed. We need more of like a holistic approach across the band, I feel, for the energy of the song to keep moving the right way. Those drums need to be amazing because of this style of music relies on the drum sound so much. I think that could be revisited, and I would try getting as much life out of each sound in the drums as you can. So like, you know, playing around with what's going on in the kick and the snare, seeing if you can make them come to life a little bit. The snare feels a little dead to me. There's not a lot of dimension to it. And then outside of that, just talking about balance for a second, I've talked about this in other streams too, but the Foo Fighters, I think, are a great example of this. They're a band where Daryl Thorpe has talked on our live streams about how Dave will just yell, "Put the guitars louder, put the guitars louder," and he feels like the vocal's getting buried. The vocal sits like right behind the snare to me in those mixes. And because you're struggling to hear Dave sometimes, and the guitars are loud and the drums are loud on top of it and everything, it really adds a whole level of energy to it. Versus like a pop thing where the vocal's sitting in front of the snare, right? So I think that if you bring those drums forward, you're going to add energy to the vocal. I'm not saying bury the vocal in the drums, but I would check out some of those mixes and just kind of look for some inspiration from other stuff in this genre and see where are the drums versus the guitars versus the vocal, and try to just reconsider your balances. That said, I would actually bring all the faders down and start with what you think is the most important element of the mix, and then start wrapping everybody else around it, and just listen for your levels. The other thing was between sections. For example, in the beginning of the song, the vocal feels buried. It comes to life where I said in the chorus, and then it's up again, I think, for like verse 2 and possibly the rest of the tune. just making sure that those sections make sense in context of each other too, and it doesn't feel like a new mix or anything like that. So yeah, I would encourage you to do a 2.0 on this. Bring the faders down, rebalance it, and see if you can make the drums speak a little bit better, and yeah, really add some energy to it, because it's a killer track. So great job. I hope that that helps. Paul Donovan and Martin and Primetime, I'll say sick track. And yeah, let's keep going. I think we got time for about two more here. Let's see what we get. Draw a track. Here we go. This is called Track Update. I don't think that's the name of the song. Okay, so I think I remember Gaxpar from a different stream, so let me just make sure I haven't heard this. Okay, let's check it out. Just going to talk about this one while we go. The snare clap that happens out in front of the vocal, very loud, and it makes the vocal feel recessed, but it actually doesn't make the vocal feel recessed. It just feels like a loud clap because we haven't heard the clap until now. In relation to the vocal, that clap is very loud. So watch out for your balance there.
Adentro, por horas incontables, sentir de nuevo, eso de que nada malo podía pasarme, te echo de menos, y ya nada. Como antes, igual de seguro nuestros cuerpos siguen haciendo perfecto encaje. Como dos pies echan medida, pero volver contigo lo sentiría como entrar por la salida. Deja la puerta entreabierta, quiero mirar una vez más tu mirada. Mañana déjalo igual, al parecer no quería ser.
There's a resonance happening in this guy that's doing the subdivisions over here, shaker, hi-hat, whatever you want to call it. There's a resonance in the upper mids here that's a little bit pokey. That could probably be taken care of with a little bit of EQ and then finding something else to make it speak a little bit. Here we go.
Cerrar todavía, cuando termine te quería. Ahora solo queda escribirte poesía, porque sabemos que volver sería como entrar por la salida. Me imagino pasándolo bien, riéndonos de tontas cosas.
I like that delayed snare sound that's happening. I feel like those delays, you could almost use that to like push back in the mix and come out wider. So like if it, you know, first hit was like close and present and then those delays kind of faded away back away from the listener, I think that would be really cool. That's a cool production choice. Here we go.
Comiendo mierda rica viendo una serie. Cuando te extraño se me olvida todo lo malo. Solo pienso en lo bonito del pasado. En la mejor cucharita que he probado. Tú mostrándome música que nunca había escuchado. No imagino pasándolo bien, riéndonos de tantas cosas como siempre. Preguntándote cuánto me querís del 1 al 10. Comiendo mierda rica viendo una serie. Yeah.
Thinking about the vocals, they feel a little quiet to me. I was just reading Tom's comment as well. He thinks that there's a little bit of a mask in the lower mids of the vocal, the 300 hertz area. I hear that too. Cutting that, turning the vocal up, that'll probably expose a lot of other stuff. But I feel like the vocal's going to be, it, right now I feel like it's bright or on the edge of bright. And I feel like if you resolve that mask, it might get a little bit too bright. So if you have a boost going on there, just... if you try cutting some of the low mid stuff, just keep an eye out on any boost that you have there because it might start getting a little bit too bright for the track, unless you like that thing. Here we go.
No te extraño, se me olvida todo lo malo. Y solo pienso en lo bonito del pasado. En la mejor cucharita que he probado. Tú mostrándome música que nunca había escuchado. Te echo de menos. Y ya nada es como antes. Igual de seguro nuestros cuerpos siguen haciendo perfecto.
Sentiría como entrar por la salida. Deja la puerta entreabierta, quiero mirar una vez más tu mirada. So on this section, I'm hearing some background vocals that sound really cool, but they're really kind of quiet and recessed. And I think that that is, there's a couple things happening. Like, I feel like the vocals are all competing in the same mid-range. So I'd watch for that. That's a common thing that happens if you record all the vocals on one microphone. It's the same characteristic. Everything's going to just start stacking and stacking and stacking and become kind of cloudy. So you might want to process those backgrounds a little bit different and then try to get them in into their own space. The synth pad that's happening is also living in that range of the vocal and like the upper mid, like the, you know, even just in the mid, like the 1K range, it's competing and causing a little bit of a mask to me with the lead vocal. So I would take a look at everybody that's happening in that range. Again, doing some prioritization, just mentally being like, who's important right now? Who's getting in the way? Who's stepping out in front of the lead character? And just working on the balance, a little bit of the tonal balance as well. If everybody's competing for that same range, not everybody can win. So just make a little bit of space for them. And Connor or Corner, thank you so much for your comment. Yeah, guys, let me know if my vocal is, if my microphone is too quiet for you guys compared to the music. I just turned it up a little bit, but let me know if it's better or not. I appreciate the feedback on that. Okay, here we go. Let's listen to the rest. Okay, awesome. The pad brings us out. That's cool. The one thing I want to point out, that resonance in the whoever's doing the subdivision, if it's a hi-hat or shaker, whatever that sound is, that resonance, I think if you resolve that, the overall level of that sound is going to come down quite a bit if it's, you know, smoothed out a little bit. It's also sticking up so much higher than the vocal and everything. I think that's part of why Tom was saying, like, I need to hear the vocals up a little bit. It's because there's this like pretty harsh sound that's louder than everybody in the balance. And then that's making you want to peer down the mix, listen through it to get to that vocal and latch onto it. So I would just consider dealing with that sound, maybe even just bringing the volume of it down. But actually try bringing the volume down before you try to EQ out the resonance and see if the resonance is even a problem if you just bring the volume back a little bit. Super cool track though. And keep going. I think this is another mix of one that you've submitted already and done some revisions on it. So I'd say keep going. I think this is going to be cool. And thanks so much for submitting it, Gexpar. I really appreciate it. And it's been fun listening to it. All right. So we got time for one more. Let's see what we get. You guys are awesome in the chat. Thank you so much for joining. And I see a lot of familiar faces every week, and it's great to see you guys. Okay, drawing a track. Riff 94, Tim Thompson. Lots going on. Does it all come through? Looking for a competitive mix. Let's check this out. Tim submitted a track a couple weeks ago, and it kind of knocked everybody's socks off. So let's see what we got. I love Tim's band. Cool song. Great writing too. That's awesome. I'll jump right in. I mean, that song is super, super awesome. Hence my head bobbing. Okay, so things that jumped out to me, besides fun, I think the acoustic guitar is a little bit loud because the low mids are taking a lot of space, but I think that the whole thing overall is popping out quite a bit. And it's competing a little bit with the bass guitar for the low mid range. And I can't hear the bass as much on this one. That last song that you did that like we were freaking out about the bass tone on. I know you got a great bass tone in there and I want to hear some more of it. So that acoustic felt like he was stealing the show a little bit to me. And the guitar playing the riff feels a little bit pokey, almost like it has a little too much compression on it, but it might have been like a pedal compressor or something. It's just getting a lot of attack from it, and it's kind of jumping out. So I felt like that on this one. For the chorus, it would be awesome to hear some background vocals in there. My initial thought was that the lead vocal was too loud there, and I do think it's like a little bit above the mix, but I wanted to hear like a chord of vocals happening with you on the chorus, just because like it's a really cool vocal happening there. There's some cool vocal arrangement that happens in other spots. I think some BGVs would sound really cool there. There's something in the EQ of the overheads. It's in the upper mids. It's making them a little bit harsh to me and taking a lot of space. So I would just take a look at how those are being treated. Then I felt like I could use a little bit more oomph out of the drums. So not necessarily like a lot of sub and attack on the kick, but like it felt like it could use some more punch. Same in the snare. I felt like just some more definition and punch on those drums would really like liven up the pushing feel of the song and help support the other cool things that are going on. There's a synth moment where they're cranked, and I freaking love that. I love stuff like that. Like I talked about Jack White's What's the Trick last week. That track is littered with stuff like that, and it's amazing. Actually, Tim, go check that track out if you haven't heard it yet. Jack White, What's the Trick? There's some like similarity tone stuff in that track, and the moments like the synth moment that I think you dig. So just for fun, not necessarily as a reference, but just for fun. I'm wondering if those synth moments could have a little bit more low end so that when they pop out, like a little low end would make me feel like they're even closer to me and jumping more at me. And then they felt a little bit pokey in the upper mids. So if they had just, you don't have to dip the upper mids. I'm thinking like just boost up the low end on that part where the synth jumps out and it might feel really awesome. Maybe try. And then just, I think the lead vocal overall could just come back a hair in the choruses, especially if you get some BGVs in there and make a little thing around them. Great song again. Love it, Tim. Cool. I'm going to put my comment in here. And before we get out of here, all right, there's a bot in here that's trying to send me to the best adult dating site. Let me deal with that real quick. Keep telling this thing that I'm married. I can't go to your dating site. Remove. Thank you. Let's put this guy in timeout, too. All right, there we go. All right, before we get out of here, Primetime Robot says, a lot of tracks this week. I hope my mix will be in there next time. Would have been great to hear Mark's comments too. So Primetime, I think, has been to almost all of these Mixtank's lives, and I'm gonna break our little like deal here, and I'll go a little bit longer so we can check out his track here. And oh yeah, okay, so a great reason to do it too. This is Guardian from Alanis Morissette. This is the song from the mixing contest that's happening over at puremix.net right now, which also reminds me, if you're watching, please do all the like and subscribe stuff. Hit the buttons that are down here somewhere, or over here, or over here, or whatever. Do the like and subscribe thing. Ring the bell. It really helps us to keep this going. If we see a lot of interaction on YouTube and all that stuff, that helps us to keep doing this every week. So please, please, please like and subscribe and support the channel. Okay, let's check this thing out. Here we go. Prime time. This is Alanis Morissette's Guardian. All right, prime time, I see you.
You who smiled when you're in pain. You who soldiered through the profane. They were distracted and shut down. So
there sounds like there's something happening in the drums here that's causing like a flam to it, almost like delay compensation's been exceeded or something like that. I just want to point that out now while I'm here. Hey, you were doing some cool stuff there on that bridge. I love what you're doing there. The if that's something like stutter edit, I would consider printing that and then maybe editing it a little bit further, because I think it ends with a breath. And I thought I heard a cut that sounded like a bad edit in there. So I would consider like cleaning it up. But I love the creativity there. Really cool. Primetime, I think you did great on this. This is cool, man. Yeah. Okay, cool. So let's see what we got going on here. So the first thing I want to point out that I noticed right away was we've heard a couple mixes on these Mixtank Lives of this song, and on almost all of them I felt like they didn't get the moments right in the arrangement of who was supposed to be in the front. And we talked a lot about that on here, and like I think that you got it. I think you like got the arrangement and understood it and pushed the right people to the front where they're supposed to be. So kudos on that. That's really important, and you got the song right. You listened to the rough and did good things with it. So that's great. Okay, so the first thing that jumps out to me is a little bit of the tone of the drums. I think there's a lot of great stuff happening here, but the there was that weird flammy thing I was hearing in the verse. Let me know in the chat if you know what that is. And in the chorus, I felt like I wasn't getting like enough punch and smack between the kick and the snare. So kick, I needed some more punch. It felt big, but it didn't feel like it had like mid-range definition or something. And then the snare, I felt like it needed to smack a little bit more, and I wanted to hear some more of those ghost notes that the drummer's playing. The drummer's killer on this, so I want to hear like some of that subtlety that he's got in his performance. Beyond that, there's a bell sound in the verses, and there's a note that gets hit that has a resonance that just decays forever to it. And I think they hit that note a couple of times, like one after the other, more so in verse two. But it's not overly loud, but like it's not that the bell is too loud, but there's a resonance that happens on one of those notes that, because it's just lingering on and on and on, it felt like feedback in my right ear. It was almost I was at an airport recently, and there was like this just emergency tone, just like that 1K tone that was just going off from one of the machines, and it was like somebody just like parked the machine, put it in reverse, and then left and just like let it ring, and it was right next to my gate, and I like had to walk away because it was any audio person would go crazy. It's just like, that's feedback. It's a pure tone or whatever. But I'm hearing that kind of thing happen from this bell sound. So I would maybe just look for that resonance and see if you could tame it a little bit, or just bring it back a hair in the mix. But again, I didn't feel the bell was necessarily too loud. It was just this resonance that was really kind of getting my ear. There's something phasey in the chorus vocals at the end. They felt like they were getting a little bit smeared or mushy in there. So yeah, a couple little things, like I would see if you can give those drums some more impact, but the on the guitars, I felt like they could use a little bit more low mid punch, just like making them a little bit bigger, but you'll have to also do that with the drums to make it make sense. So they could have some more power, but the drums need a little bit more power too. If you have stuff going on your mix bus, I don't think this is a mix bus EQ thing, but just watch out that you're not cutting too much of the meat of the sounds and all that. And then I'm sure, like, I see Sonic commented on this and Tom's commented on that. I'm sure that their comments are super, super useful as well. I didn't read them yet. They could be totally different from mine, but both those guys know what they're doing. So check those things out. And again, I feel like you got the parts. You understood the parts and who's supposed to be where. So again, great job, because this is the first one I've heard that on. So very cool. And thank you so much for being here every Monday. It's been amazing to see you in the chat and everything. So thanks. Oh, cool. Valhalla I used at the end. Very nice. Oh, like Shimmer. Shimmer is just Shimmer. Valhalla Shimmer. If you use that and it's kind of random every time, I would consider like committing it, just that section, or like printing that part of it and then doing a little cleanup in the audio from there. But yeah, like you can totally print an effect like that and then keep manipulating it and all that. Carl says, do one more for the road. All right. Alexander asks, what are your favorite mixes that you listen to for inspiration? I need stuff to add to my playlist. Awesome. Okay. Alexander, let me answer that real quick. So, I don't know if I put it in favorite mix yet, but I heard, and I talked about it last week on the show, Jack White's What's the Trick jumped out to me as one badass mix, last week. And it was also the production of it. But man, that thing is exciting. There's something new that happens every four bars, and everything's just, you know, got so much character to it. It's great. I love a ton of Adam Hawkins mixes. I think that guy's great. He mixed a record from a band called Turnstile that I think turned out really awesome recently. And then there's a song, I talked about it also on a show. Sohn is the artist, S-O-H-N. The song is Signal. And I listened to that one as a reference for two things. One is like the side stick is super dry, so I can tell what a room feels like if I play this track. And then at the end, everything gets so big that the mix starts to collapse in on itself, but in a really cool way. It feels like if you're listening to it from a nerd standpoint, you'd be like, oh, it's starting to push the compressor, but it feels awesome and it does exactly what the song wants it to do. So I use that as a reminder that perfect isn't good. And then, look up Vance Powell's playlist. He's one of the most creative mixers out there and doing some amazing stuff, breaking rules all the time, and it's amazing. So many good things. I talk about the Foo Fighters mixes from Daryl Thorpe on here quite a bit as like sort of a reference for like vocal level in rock music. And then I think that the new Kendrick record sounds amazing. There's so much good stuff coming out right now. I'm going to start doing more of those too. Like when we do the Mix Tank Takeover at the beginning of the show, I'm going to try and like share tracks and all that stuff that I've been listening to. Primetime night. let's see. So, okay. Thanks, Jeff. I'm glad it helped out. Carl, let's do one more for the road. What do you guys say? I think we still got a couple people watching. All right, let's do it. Let's draw one for the road. Then we'll get out of here. We just did that one. Okay, I haven't heard this yet. Black Rabbit, Kagaret, number 5. Here we go. Or just 5. He didn't put a number sign in front of it. Here we go. Primetime, help me make that plug-in. That'd be awesome.
I could have left a while ago. You could have changed direction. Why do we always seem to find ourselves in disconnection? We could agree to disagree. We could have found concession. But that's not the way with you and me. No, it won't work this time. 'Cause all that's left is a broken.
Sorry, I'm just going to make a note about the vocal tuning. Something grabbed my ear here. But I wanted to be specific about it, so I'm just putting a timestamp on it. There you go. And let's keep going.
All that's left is a broken memory. And all we had, we may have been too blind to see. I don't care much for your mouth. Not that it makes much difference. It's getting too hot inside. I just wanna bum a cigarette.
Okay, a couple things. On the end of Cigarette, I felt the vocal edit happen there that made it disappear. And I think that that's because Sonic Science looks like he's covered this pretty well here. So the content that's happening above 10K, and he says around 75K in particular. I don't know about the numbers, but this vocal is very bright to me. And I hear a little like, I don't know the word for this. And if you guys know in the chat, tell me. But the phase that happens inside of a signal when, like, if you have kind of a bad EQ that causes, all EQs cause phase shift when you boost and cut and all that. But when they do it a lot and it doesn't sound good, and it kind of makes your signal fall apart, I'm hearing that on this vocal. And he's saying it's similar to what multiband compression does. So maybe it's multiband compression happening, but there's a ton of top end in this vocal. Bright vocals are not always the way. It's like adding that like sheen and top end to them, like the Fresh Air thing does from Slate. It has to be the right track for that kind of stuff. Like R&B, pop, I get it, like for sure. But if there's too much of it on there, Sugar, our plugin from Process Audio, will also do this top end trick, but a little goes a long way. And if you put too much on it, that top end starts feeling really odd and a little bit too bright and harsh. And it pulls the vocal out of the track, like almost like it's sitting, on the second story and the rest of the band's on the first story of the building or something like that. If you're looking at a building, you've got the band down here, you got the vocal up here because there's so much top end on it. So just watch out that it's not too much and sounding separated from the rest of the track with it. I'm actually having a little bit of a hard time focusing on the rest of the instrumentation and the parts that are happening in the lyric because that vocal is so bright that it's I felt like I had to comment about that so we could move on with it. So there we go. Let's listen.
Is this a sinking ship we're on? Does it even matter? Not gonna tuck my tail.
You know, if you actually removed all your processing and then rebalanced this, I think that it would speak as a song a lot better. Not that the whole mix is bad. I'm not saying that. It sounds like I just said that. I'm not definitely not saying that. But I think if you find the song with the faders, if that makes sense, if you find the song with the faders first and then do the embellishment on the individual sounds to make them more exciting, I think that the song is going to speak better. I'm hearing like some mid-range buildup in the pad, the strings, the pad thing, and the piano. And I'm imagining these sounds as a more natural thing. And I would hear this great song popping out because it sounds like there's one here. So let's take a listen.
Sailing run, I'm sure you'd be much faster. Cause all that's left is a shitty reverie. And all we have might be better to set free. I don't care much for your mouth. Not that it makes much difference. It's getting too hot inside. I just want to bum a cigarette. Too proud to back it down. And too dumb to back it up anyway. Don't want to fight.
The strings are loud to the point here where I can't hear the subdivision or the rhythm coming from the piano, and it's making me lose the groove a little bit. So just watch out that the pads and the string thing don't mask up what's going on with the piano. The piano is it's the vocal, the piano for me on this mix. Like the other stuff is the wallpaper, and I need to feel the groove with the piano player. Like there's not too much reverb around it taking away the notes, and I need that vocal to be really, you know, just gorgeous sounding and full and strong. It's got a little, like, doesn't sound like Bruce Springsteen, but it's got that style of music where it's like, this is supposed to be the strong male character. And right now he's kind of got a little bit of the Ariana Grande thing going on, lots of top end on there. I think he needs to, you know, go do a little bit of construction work and get some grit on his face. Here we go.
This time, I just wanna bum a cigarette. Difference, it's getting too hot inside. I just want to bum a cigarette. Too proud to back it down, and too dumb to back it up anyway. Don't want to fight this time. I just want to bum a cigarette.
Cool lyrics.
I don't want to fight this time. I just want to bum a cigarette.
All right, nice one. Cool, yeah, that's a really good song there. Very nice. Yeah, very nice. Let me comment on this one here. Prime time, I forgot to comment on yours. Yeah, this is a really, really good song. Martin said so as well in the chat. So great job, Black Rabbit. This is cool. I think if you just work a little bit of the stuff out that I mentioned, this is going to feel great. And you said that you eased the high end on the vocal back and checked the de-essing before. I think I remember this track, In Pursuit of the Fluttering some Sound Mentioned, cleaned all the tracks when not active. Should have done that anyway. Okay, cool. Yeah, so yeah, you're working through some of the edits and stuff like that. Yeah, I'd say keep going with it. And yeah, consider doing a save as and pulling it back to the basic tracks and then focusing in on the vocal and the fact that this is a beautiful song, and really just supporting that lead vocal and bringing it out. But I think this is on the way. If you do another version, please submit it. I'd love to hear where this goes. So and also, like, feel free to leave me a comment here. I'll hear about it, so it'll notify me and all that stuff. Guys, thank you so much for tuning in again. I'll be back here next Monday, 2:30 p.m. A reminder that this is the last week to submit your Alanis Morissette Guardian mixes, so please get those in there. Prime time, I want to see yours in there. You got to do it. Very cool. And let's see. Yeah, Jeff, thanks for watching. Martin, thanks for watching. Carl, thanks for pushing us to do one more. And Alexander, I hope that helped on the reference mixes, the ones I like a lot. I'll keep thinking through that and add some more. Oh, I got one more for you. Fab DuPont mixed a song called Zephyr from a band called Tomboy. And let me see if I can just drop a link to the chat in there real quick. Hold on. Let's see. No. Hold on 1 second. I'm going to get this for you guys. So it's TM Boy Zephyr. Let me put this in SongWhip. If you guys don't know SongWhip, it's pretty awesome. It's a link aggregator. So you just go to songwhip.com, paste the song that you want, and it'll pop out a link page for you, like this one, to any streaming service that you want. I'll put this in the chat. Specifically on this song, Fab does something really cool to the high vocal that happens in the bridge, and the vocal feels like it goes away from you, and then it starts like swirling around the back of the mix or whatever, like, you know, like it's doing one of these things behind the rest of the mix. And it's one of my favorite lessons in depth in mixing or whatever. It's just like she's singing really powerfully and then something just pulls her and sucks her away from the rest of the mix. So very cool song. This is also one of my favorite bands. They get like 20 streams a month on Spotify. It's a crime. So tell your friends about them if you like them. And yeah, with that, I'll see you guys next week. Thank you so much for joining us. Thanks for your continued support on the channel. Thanks for liking and subscribing. And yeah, we'll see you next time. Thanks, everybody. Bye. I have to hit the right button. I found the right button. Thanks for watching. See ya.